Corey here. I am getting ready to do, it looks like it's gonna be two rooms, a hall and stairs. So pretty small. It is, it's Olaf and Berber. It's not crazy dirty, so it shouldn't be just too much trouble to get back looking great again. Olaf and Berber, for the people that watch the show and they're trying to learn how to clean carpet, Olaf and Berber is generally the nemesis of certainly steam cleaning. Trouble when you're cleaning with steam is it rinses out really well. You know, you put down any kind of product basically, and pH has got to be high enough to move the soil in it. But the problem is when you steam it, you know, you're popping the PSI off at about 300-400 PSI, depending on how dirty it is and what you want to run it at. But generally what'll happen is it looks like you've done just a splendid job, you know, and I used to have the same issue. You know, you pull a trigger on a wand and you basically look like you've erased, you know, a 12-inch section. And you're taking out a considerable amount of soil, but the problem is that, you know, when you hit it with 300-400 PSI, the first thing you do is you blast the soil down into the carpet, then you vacuum a portion of it out. Now, it looks like you've restored it to brand new when you clean it with steam. Problem is during the drying process, all the soil that you didn't remove will come back to the top. So it'll have a dingy look to it. And a lot of times what'll happen is, say a kid spilled a Coke or something, and they did a pretty decent job of getting it off the top of the carpet. Well, that's still down in the backing of the carpet. It's probably in the pad too. So when you come through it and you're steaming it, you re-wet that. And then, you know, carpet dries through a process called wicking, which is basically the moisture leaving the carpet. It rises up. So when the moisture is rising out of the carpet, it's pulling. You know, the top layer of moisture dries off and then more rises to the top. So it's pulling the soil in the bottom to the top. So it'll give you that nasty kind of, like you left a hero and then in 2 days' time, you're the villain because, you know, sometimes people have a stain where they never had an issue before, you know, and you've got to be able to, the main thing is you've got to be able to explain to people, you know, kind of how this works and to expect that. And if it does happen, now with VLM, it doesn't happen. It's rare to never. But you've got to be able to explain to people, tell them that you'll be back to fix it. You know, if there's a problem, just call, let me know. And generally, like when I used to clean with steam from 01 to 06, I would have to go back to a couple different houses every week that had an Olaf and Berber. Because once they get really dirty, you've got to get fairly medieval on them, you know, with steam to try to get it to come back to clean again. And all the extra rinsing you have to do is when it shoots you in the foot and it'll give you problems. But not so with VLM. Let me show you what I'm working with here. It's weird how I used to feel like Olaf and Berber was the absolute most difficult, but now I feel like the Frise is maybe just a little more difficult to clean. But the Frise won't wick like Berber will. Hang on, here we go. Also make Berber out of nylon, but this is not. This is olefin. And olefin, when you touch it, nylon will have a soft touch to it. It'll feel soft. This stuff, you can skin your knee on it. It's glorified plastic. It's coarse and it's rough. This one is beaten down. But generally, you could like fall down and skin your knee on this stuff. It's very abrasive. It'll last a long time. It'll definitely last a long time. Now, it's one of the more difficult ones to repair. It can be difficult to repair, a little harder to repair. It's more involved. So this is pretty friendly here. The other room looks like it's got something in it. Now there's a seam here, and that's what you got to watch out for with Berber. That's where the carpet was joined together. And generally when you seam Berber, you don't cut across the grain, you cut with the grain. So you bring them together and, it's starting to come loose from foot traffic. This room looks like it's got a little bit going on here, so I may do a light scrub here just to make sure I get this looking the way I want. I'm using Rug Restore today. It's a little stronger product from Challenger. I'm gonna go ahead and this will start right here. I'm gonna pre-spray this and we'll come back and I'm gonna clean it. This one won't get a pre-scrub and this one will. So just go a little slower on this one. I'm going to be using the Challenger pads today. Where are they at? Yeah, right here. These are the ones that we make here at Challenger. This is a 17. This is a 20. And that's a 17. It worked good. I prefer the 20 myself. Anyway, I'm gonna get the spraying over here, and we'll come back and watch the cleaning. All right, we'll pre-treat it in real time. Then I will speed up the cleaning with the time lapse. All right, now we'll switch over to time lapse here and shine it all up real pretty. So just finished up in there. The thing about a Berber carpet is you don't need to groom it. It's a full loop carpet. It's not a cut pile. By cut pile, I mean you have tufts sticking up, and this is a continuous thread that goes in and out of the backing of the carpet. So it doesn't need to be groomed. There's no benefit to it. So if you're trying to learn how to clean carpet, you don't groom Berber. Sometimes with a nylon Berber, you can put little swirlies in it that look better if you groom them. Sometimes. But olefin, there's really nothing special to be done. It looks like I just might be able to not have to. Now I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to go ahead and scrub it. Anyway, I'm going to go ahead and do the pre-spray. And then we'll come back and you'll see me scrub, and then I will put the extraction bonnet on and extract the soil. All right, we're gonna do a little scrubbing here to begin with. we're not gonna scrub the whole room. Whole room didn't need scrubbing. I'm gonna get the traffic areas, which is kind of hard to see actually. Since I sprayed it, it's starting to oxidize here and lighten up anyway, but anyway, we're gonna scrub at it, and then we'll come back clean. Scratching bonnet on it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to switch out and put the bonnet over that I had over there. I'm going to turn it over and we'll use the clean side. All right. Now this is the bonnet that was used over there. That's the side I used. So we're going to flip it over and use this side now. So, yeah. Steam guys like to try to harass you about where the dirt goes. They just don't understand it. Well, where the dirt goes in this particular method is legal as compared to where the dirt goes when you're steam cleaning. Most of the time when guys are steam cleaning, they'll open the valve to their tank and they'll dump it on the street out front, which is a $10,000 fine. That is polluting groundwater. So these guys, they take it home and they go into the wash, and that puts its dirt into the city sewer, which is legal. If you're cleaning with steam and you're gonna dump your solution, you dump your water basically, you can dump it into, you can go to the car wash, you can leave where you're at, go to the car wash and dump it into there, or you can empty it into buckets and take it inside and pour it into people's toilet. Or if you're lucky enough, and it's available outside, there's a little cap that runs that's between the house and the street. Take the top off of that cap and it gives you access to the sewer. You can dump the water in that, and that's legal. But very few guys actually go to the trouble to dump the water legally because it takes too much damn time. You know, and when you're cleaning with steam, you're in a hurry. You gotta stack them deep and hurry, hurry, hurry. You know, steam is about working fast. So, a lot of advantages to this. Main thing is never to come back and fix anything. Alright, now we're going to clean it. clean this little area right here now. Area that I couldn't get because the camera's in the way. Let's take a look at what we've got out of this one here. It is about the same as the other. And that's very light soil. When you're doing heavy soil, looks like this room, this side, and this side was the first room. So very similar. When you're doing a carpet that is truly, truly, truly filthy, these things will turn black on you. And they will, you know, they eventually quit absorbing because there's no more room inside it to hold any more dirt. All right, now I gotta clean where I'm standing here, so I'm probably gonna not show this part, and then we're gonna do a before and after on the stairs. Stairs have got, you can see the soil in the stairs. Stairs are generally always hardest. You've got to either add quite a bit of agitation to the stairs, or you've got to increase the strength of your chemical to get the carpet to release the soil on the stairs, especially the first couple steps. Because generally when you walk upstairs, you're not just stepping, you're also just stepping and twisting. So you're grinding the soil into the center of the carpet fiber. Much more difficult. All right, quick little look over here. And this video is not all that great because there's not that much distance to go between being clean and dirty here. So anyway, these steps are gonna knock all of that soil off them. Take a look over the edge here. Yeah, you can see the track coming up here. We're gonna try to knock all of it off. That is extremely difficult. But I'm gonna hit it really hard with some chemical. Mix it a little stronger and take my time cleaning. I'm going to use the work on it. So anyway, we'll come back and try to look from the same angle when I'm done so you can compare right now to when I'm done. So here goes. All right. That's what I was looking for. All right, finally done here. Take a look. I turn the lights off and left the fans on. You always want to leave the fans on so you speed your dry time up. It helps prevent licking. All right, guys, I appreciate you watching the video. If you have questions, you're welcome to put them in the comments and I will try to take care of them in the next video. If you're interested in purchasing Challenger, you're welcome to text me. It's 512-350-1129. It gets you $100 off and help you get lined out on using the machine. All right, guys, I'm gonna roll back to the house and I'm done for the day. Thanks for watching and God bless. See you tomorrow.